as a self or whatever on January 30th, 19, whatever. And other people feel that it sort of creeps up incrementally, like a thief in the night, I think was Christ's phrase. And so what has your personal experience been, and what has been your experience in working with students with regard to having an awakening? You know, how would you even define awakening? Because there are a lot of different, the word's thrown a lot around a lot, and I don't think everybody understands it in the same way.
It's a very good question. In Sat Yoga, we speak of awakening as the first stage of a process. The second is illumination, and the final stage is liberation. And awakening can be of many sorts, because you can awaken to different things, and you can have a partial awakening. For example, you could awaken to the fact that you have an unconscious mind that's sabotaging you, that you weren't fully aware of. You could awaken to the fact that you're being controlled by society in certain ways. You could awaken to the fact that there is more happening in the phenomenal plane in terms of subtle entities and energies and that kind of thing, but it's not a complete awakening. You could awaken to Kundalini or Shaktipat. You can awaken to events and phenomena that create a kind of change of frame of reference, let's say. But they don't necessarily create a shift of assemblage point. So the real awakening is when your assemblage point shifts and you move up from those lower three to chakra four and above. Okay, so I would say chakra four is the beginning of an awakening. We didn't even ever talk about five, six, or seven.
We can still do that.
So that the awakening is to the fact that there is more than I imagined to reality, more than I imagined to myself, and also less, because the ego is false. And I think the awakening to the falseness and the constructed aspect of the ego, that it's not real, and that your ego is made up of projections that other people put into you. Because you're originally, you aren't born with an ego, but you are born with a desire to receive love and to be supported lovingly. And if your parents made certain demands on you to be a certain way, then you may have given in, you may have adopted their projections, like your mother says, oh, you're just like Uncle Louie, the alcoholic, and you know, that may well become part of your ego. You think it was you, but no, you were trying to satisfy her demand to be what she thought of you, or in obviously millions of permutations of that. So the ego is a complex construct that comes from outside in, and then it's added to by society's demands and the fact that we learn to function in language. Language is not reality. Language is a representation of reality. But once we get addicted to language, we stop feeling our heart. We stop being literally in our bodies and in reality as it is. Even the Maya of the cosmic level, we're not in. We're in our heads and our fantasies and our worries and our past memories and nostalgias. So once one awakens to the fact that the ego is false and has nothing to do with the self, one can have a satori, in which that falls away. And then suddenly there's like emptiness and one sees the world with new eyes and there can be an opening to love and all of that. But usually it's temporary. And then the ego closes in again and there's even more defense mechanisms and people say, what happened? They thought they had reached, you know, God and the end of the journey, and it turned out it wasn't. And then that's when the real inner work starts. Like, what happened? And what do I have to deal with? And the elimination of the ego, because of its homeostatic nature, it wants to keep itself just as it always was. It doesn't want to change. It doesn't want to grow. Requires a lot of work on the shifting of the dynamics of the ego itself. And that's the purification of the soul and the processes that we do here, so that the grip of the ego on our consciousness loosens and finally lets go.
Okay, so you define awakening in a somewhat relative sense, that one awakens to a deeper reality or to a realization that there's more than one had suspected and so on, and there are many, obviously many things which can trigger that. Many people who take LSD for the first time have that kind of experience of, whoa, I didn't realize. But then you mentioned the term illumination. And did you just actually touch upon what you mean by illumination and what you
just
said?
No, we didn't really get to that one yet.
So where would what would that be?
Illumination happens when one goes deep enough that there's a realization that what the world itself was an illusion. And it's really all simply light. And one enters a field of infinite light, divine light, and it's blissful light. And one can bathe in that. That's the original meaning of baptism, actually. It's the bathing in an ocean of light. And one can come back from that illumination in a totally transformed way. And it has much more of a powerful effect on one's life. This happens with near-death experiences, by the way, when people go into the light, literally, and they come back without most of their ego.
Right.
It doesn't get rid of all of it, but it purifies it. And then one's life is completely different, and of course it produces healings of physical illnesses and all kinds of karma. So your life can change in a very radical way. But it's still not liberation, because there is still a living within the illusion, and there the very core of the desire to be a creature, someone, an I am-ness, has to be ultimately released for that final stage of union with the Absolute.
And that would be your liberation, final stage of union with the Absolute?
Yes.
And would you please describe the subjective experience of that?
It's not subjective. There is no subject left. There is neither subject nor object. That's why it can never be described. There is no mind able to grasp it. You are it, but because of the infinite nature of it, it can never be defined. And the closest they have ever gotten, I think, is Satchitananda. But that doesn't tell you all that much. But what we are is pure, blissful intelligence that is formless and non-localizable beyond space and time and absolute infinite awareness without any sense of an individuality.
Would you consider liberation as you define it to be 24/7, stable, unperturbable by any circumstances?
Yes, or else it's not liberation.
I interviewed a guy about a month ago who has sort of been in that state and more for most of his life, and you know, people were commenting, is this guy real? I mean, you know, how could he have lived such a charmed life and always been in such a state? And what would happen if he were tortured? You know, what would happen if they started describing all these gory things? What would happen? How would he react to that? And he just responded, I wish I could call it up in a second, I'd read it, but it was basically, within the awakened heart, all that would be sort of, it would just be something taking place within a much larger context, and it couldn't disrupt that larger context. Those weren't his words, but that's what he meant to say. Do you concur with that notion that there's nothing which can disrupt or destroy the realized state if it's the real thing?